Hello! In this lecture, I would like to highlight some distinctive features of Russian norms of behavior. On the one hand, cultural values determine what people consider appropriate behavior and how they interact with each other. On the other hand, proper behavior is one of the important values in any culture. Describing national etiquette always carries the risk of oversimplification and stereotyping. And Russia is no exception. Indeed, Russian citizens are not a homogeneous group of people, and there are differences in cultural norms between people depending on their age, education, socioeconomic status, and their place of residence. Some rules of behavior of the European part of the Russian Federation differ from the norms of its Asian parts, while the etiquette of urban dwellers and their rural counterparts also vary. Russian etiquette has more similarities than differences with continental Europe. In Russia, people eat with a fork in their left hand and a knife in their right hand. Phrases like "thank you," "you're welcome," and "excuse me" are considered good manners. Finally, social media rules, such as not to overshare by making too many postings about yourselves, are universal. However, some norms of behavior are different from other nations because are shaped by Russia's unique location, a long history of hardships, and collectivist traditions. Such feature of Russian national character as hospitality, willingness to share, love for celebrating events, openness, and concern about others manifest in Russian etiquette. Russian etiquette is undergoing significant changes. For example, in post-Soviet Russia, people were eager to discuss politics. But recent political polarization of society made this topic taboo, not only among strangers, but among close friends and family members. The topics of Ukraine and Crimea are forbidden. I know a few people who cut their relatives off and broke their relationships with friends due to different political views. Despite the thousand-year-old history of Christianity, folk beliefs from the pagan past manifest themselves in modern Russian etiquette. Thus, old beliefs in the existence of the Russian domovoi. This creature is mostly kind, and it protects the family, particularly children and animals. But they can be cruel as well, if the family doesn't respect domovoi. The belief in domovoi resulted in several rules which may seem irrational to Westerners. Russians believed that whistling inside the house could scare domovoi away and cause him to abandon the house. Therefore, according to the modern norms of behavior, it is inappropriate to whistle at home. Although not many Russians know why. Also, the etiquette forbids shaking hands through a threshold because this is the place where domovoi sleeps. Many Russian social rules of conduct are based on the principles of collectivism. Some Westerners are shocked by some of Russian people's behavior, particularly by their directness and readiness to get involved in affairs of others. This behavior is perceived as a lack of boundaries, an invasion to their private space. Russian hospitality, which Russians tend to express in insisting on eating what they think is delicious food or drinking too much alcohol, may seem to travelers as intrusive and difficult to tolerate. Russian verbal etiquette has some peculiarities. Let's take a look at how Russians address to each other by names. However, first I would like to provide some information about Russian names. Russian full names are gender-specific. Alexander for male and Alexandra for females. And the nickname is the same for male and females, Sasha. Official names consist of a first patronymic derived from one's father's name and the family name. For example, Fyodor, first name, Mikhailovich, patronymic name, Dostoevsky, family name. Names take various forms by adding attitude suffixes. Let's take a look at how the name Alexander changes with a person's age. According to an official birth certificate, a child's name is Alexander. He may be called Sashenka through his life by his mother. It's an endearing form. When he goes to school, he is called Sasha, or sometimes Sashka, as a form of approval by his close friends. In higher grades, teachers may use his full name, Alexander, or his last name only. In the adult world, he is called Alexander Petrovich, his first and his patronymic name, and occasionally he may be called Sashenka again by his future wife. Addressing unknown people is problematic. In communist times, comrade, товарищ, was the general form of address. In post-Soviet Russia, there were attempts to revive pre-revolutionary сударь and сударыня, but they became archaic, and all attempts to revive them failed because it seemed artificial and pretentious. Addressing young people, молодой человек, young man, and девушка, young woman, are widely used. Yet recently these forms have been considered inappropriate because they emphasize a person's age. In official and business circles, and in writing, господин and госпожа are used. Many people still feel uncomfortable with these forms. They argue that the original meanings of these words are male and female master, and in modern colloquial Russian, these forms of address are not used. So how do Russians address unknown people? They solve this problem by using impersonal forms as простите and извините, both mean excuse me, or будьте любезны, could you please. There are three words for hello in the Russian language. Здравствуйте means to be healthy, and it is used as a formal hello or to address more than one person. Здравствуй is a less formal greeting used to address one person, while another informal greeting, привет, is used only with close friends, family members, or among young people. Russians do not use how are you, как дела, as an integral part of a greeting, but they ask this question when they mean it and want to know how a person is doing. Hence, Russians do not ask how are you when they just met a person. When they do ask, they expect to hear a genuine answer. Russians are not good at small talks. They are not keen on talking to strangers unless they are at the bar or on a train. But even in these situations, they discuss personal stuff and don't care much about the weather. One of the possible explanations for this rejection of Anglophone norm of politeness may be a concern about being perceived as insincere. They consider so-called weather talk artificial and shallow. Hiding one's thoughts and feelings may be interpreted in Russian culture as lying. This avoidance may be perceived by a Westerner as an excessive directness or uncontrolled spontaneity. The Russian language has two pronouns for addressing, an informal second person singular ты and a formal second personal plural pronoun вы. Using ты and вы is not reciprocal. For example, it is common for adults to address children and teenagers with informal ты, while children are expected to address adults by formal вы. This rule does not apply to immediate family members and grandparents. In general, it is always better to use formal вы because inappropriate use of informal ты is considered rude. There is a special term for a wrong use of ты, тыканье, which has no direct equivalent in English. Therefore, тыканье was translated as familiarity in one of the English translations of Turgenev's novel Fathers and Sons. He didn't know whether to feel flattered or offended at Bazarov's unexpected familiarity. To avoid similarly awkward situations, Russians who think they have established friendly and close relationships with another person actually suggest to switch over to ты. Informal ты may convey an additional meaning of closeness and affection rather than disrespect or insult. Pushkin's famous verse, thou and you, is an example of how informal tea may demonstrate some important changes in relations and convey additional meanings of affection and intimacy. She substituted by chance for empty you the gentle thou, and all my happy dreams at once in loving heart again resound. In bliss and silence do I stay, unable to maintain my role. Oh, how sweet you are, I say, how I love thee, says my soul. Also, I would like to say a few words about nonverbal communication. If a close physical contact may be perceived by a Westerner as an invasion, for Russians physical proximity often means closeness and friendliness. Thus, giving each other a hug with a pat on the back would be quite common for saying goodbye, while a bear hug with a not-so-gentle pat on the back is less widely used, and it would imply men who know each other quite well. Handshake plays a very important role in Russian culture. The Russian handshake is firm with a direct eye contact. In Russia, shaking hands is more common among men. For men, it is important that you shake hands on the first meeting with everyone, whether you know them or not. Men do not initiate handshakes with women, but wait when a woman extends her hand. It is considered impolite and a bad luck to shake hands with gloves on, or, as I mentioned already in this lecture, over a threshold. In comparison to North Americans, Russians use a greater variety of gestures. However, Russians do not use gestures as much as Italians. Among the most common ones is a thumbs up as a sign of approval. Spreading one's hands, развести руками, is used to express disappointment and giving up. The fig means you will not get it, and it is considered to be rude. Also, it is impolite to point at somebody using an index finger. If pointing is unavoidable, Russians use the whole hand. Another important nonverbal sign of communication, the smile, plays a different role in the life of Russians in comparison to Westerners. In Russian culture, the smile is personal, not social. Therefore, Russians do not smile out of being polite at unknown people. Moreover, Russians consider a social smile as insincere, and they often give an example of a stereotypical American smile as artificial. People tend to smile more at small children or dogs and use a half smile as a substitute for a smile. This is all I wanted to share with you about Russian etiquette. I would like to conclude this lecture with it's a short video of a young man who made a date with a girl he just met. It is an example of differences in cultural norms between people depending on their age. In Russia, this behavior would be considered resourceful by young people, but unacceptable by those who are in their 30s. This is where I say goodbye and see you next time.
Да ладно, Ваня, не парься, давай. Познакомься сейчас с какой-нибудь девчонкой. Но надо как-то... Во! Смотри, смотри, смотри. Смотри, какая девочка, а?
Ну.
Ну,
ну давай, смотри. Попробуй.
Девушка, давайте познакомимся.
Здравствуйте, я тороплюсь.
Да? Да? Может, кофе попьем?
Да. Я бы кофе с радостью, но тороплюсь и купить негде.
Давай.
Стою, да где куда? Непонятно.
Ты...
Спасибо большое.
Ну, пожалуйста.
С удовольствием.
А телефончик?
Ой, не поверите, нету. Потеряла.
Ну,
я
это...
вчера потеряла. Прикалываюсь,
наверное, специально говорю. Давай, Ник.
Девушка, возьми телефончик, я позвоню.
Нормально. Ты нормальный парень, да? У него кофе, мой телефон.
Пацану, ну,
поехали же.
Куда ты? Пишите, я сейчас наберу.
Догоняй! Поехали, это мой телефон, Вадик!
Я встречу заберу, сейчас договорились.
Да.
Слушай, нормально, Ваня, поехали.
Алло!
Да привет. Куда он красный уже горит?
Меня Вадим зовут. Очень приятно.
Клюнуло.
А давайте все-таки кофе попьем вечерком. Да, знаю, отличное место, договорились.
Как?
В 7 часов. Здорово. До свидания. Да. До свидания.
Отлично, поехали.